people need to learn to use standardized measures for things. So take me, for example. When I drive anywhere, I drive in miles, I drive in miles per hour. My fuel economy is measured in miles per gallon. But of course, I don't pump fuel in gallons, I pump it in liters. Right. And then, but when I run anywhere, so short distances, I run in kilometers, and I run in kilometers per hour. So I'm using two different systems there. And any short distances I'm measuring are going to be in meters, not feet. Right. So if I'm measuring, let's say, around my house for painting, I'm going to measure in square meters so I know how much paint to buy. But then, if I'm selling a house or I'm buying a house, I'm going to be looking at the size of the house in square feet. Right. So again, who knows why? British people. Right. If I'm baking anything, it's going to be weight in grams or kilograms going into the recipe. But if I'm weighing myself, it's going to be in stones and pounds. But of course, a ton would, for me, would be a metric ton, not an imperial ton. And as I said, I measure fuel in litres, and most of my liquids are measured in litres, except, of course, for beer and milk, which are in pints. So this is the kind of problem you're going to be dealing with when you're looking at data and you're trying to transform your data into a usable form. Maybe the data's coming from different sources. None of it goes together. You need standardized units, standardized scales, so we can go on and analyze it. So let's think back. What we're doing is we're trying to prepare our data into the densest, most clean format so that we can apply modeling or machine learning or some kind of statistical test to work out what's going on and draw knowledge from our data. So this is going to be an iterative process. We're going to be cleaning the data, we're going to transform the data, and then we're going to reduce the data. And transforming data is what we're going to do today. So let's imagine that you've cleaned your data. So we've got rid of as many missing variables as possible, hopefully all of them. We've deleted instances and attributes that just were not going to work out for us. Now what we're going to try and do is we're going to try and transform our data so that everything's on the same scale, right? Everything makes sense together. And if we're bringing data sets from different places, we need to also make sure all the units are the same and everything makes sense. There's no point in trying to use machine learning or clustering or any other mechanism to draw knowledge from our data if our data is all wrong. So today we're going to be looking at census data. Now, census data is kind of a classic example of a kind of data you might look at in data analysis. It's got lots of different kinds of attributes, things that are going to need cleaning up and transforming. Right? So we're back in R. We're going to read the census data using census is read CSV. So we've downloaded some census data that represents samples from the US population to begin with. We're going to read that in. And you can see that we've got 32,000 observations and 15 attributes or variables is what R refers to them as. So let's have a quick look at just a little bit of it and we can see the kind of thing we're looking at. So we're going to say head of census. Right? And that's just going to produce the first few rows so we can kind of see the kind of data. So you can see we've got age, we've got what working classification that person has, their educational level, a numerical representation of that, whether they're married or not, this kind of thing. So there's a lot of different kinds of data here. Some of it's going to be nominal. So for example, this working class, state government, private employee, that's a nominal value. We might have ordinal values or ratio values or interval values, right? We're going to have to delve in a little bit closer to find out what these are. Now, what we do to transform this data into a usable format for clustering or machine learning is going to depend on exactly what these types of these columns are and what we want to do with them. So let's look at just a couple of the attributes and see what we can do with them. Right? We're going to use a process called codification. The idea is that maybe things like random forests or multi-layer perceptrons, you know, neural networks, aren't going to be very amenable to putting in text-based input. So what we want to do is try and replace these attributes with a numerical score. Right? So let's look at, just for example, the working class. And also, for example, the educational level, so education. Now, work class is the kind of class of worker that we're looking at here. So, for example, a state worker or in private sector or someone that works in a school or something like this. Now, this is a nominal value. That means there's no order to this data at all. We can't say that someone in state is higher or lower than someone in private. And we can't also say that, let's say, state is two times more or less than some other one. That makes no sense at all. Right. So what we can replace this with numbers. So let's say we could replace private with zero and state with one and, you know, self-employed with two and so on. Right? And that's a perfectly reasonable thing to do, but it's still nominal data. So what we can't do is then calculate a mean and say, oh, the mean is halfway between private and public. That doesn't make any sense. Just because something has been replaced by a numerical score doesn't mean that it actually represents something that we can quantify in that way. Right? It's still nominal data. Okay, so the best advice I can give is feel free to codify your data into easy to read numbers, but just bear in mind that you can calculate the mode, just like, you know, the most common, but you can't calculate the median and you can't calculate the mean. Another example would be something like the educational level. Now, theoretically, this is ordinal data. So we could say that someone with an undergraduate degree is maybe slightly higher in terms of the amount of time they spent in education than someone with a high school diploma. But we don't know exactly what the distance is, and what's the distance between, let's say, a high school and a degree, and then a PhD, and so on, an MD, and things like this. We can represent these using numbers, and probably in order, right? So we could say that zero is no education, and one is sort of the end of primary school, and two is the end of high school, and so on and so forth. But again, it's difficult to calculate distances between these things, right? We don't know that high school is two times more than primary school, and half of a degree, or something like that. That doesn't really make sense. So again, you might be able to calculate a median on this or a mode, but you can't calculate an average. You can't say the average level of education is halfway between high school and undergraduate. That doesn't make any sense either. So for any kind of attribute that is nominal or possibly ordinal and is sort of represented using text, we can codify this so that it's more amenable to things like decision trees, depending on the library you're using, right? But you just have to be careful. All machine learning algorithms will take any number you give them, and you just have to be careful that this makes sense to do. So what you would do is you would go through your data and you'd begin to systematically replace appropriate attributes with numerical versions of themselves, remembering all the time that they don't necessarily represent true numbers, you know, in a ratio or interval format. So for any text-based value, we're going to start replacing them possibly with numerical scores. What about the numerical values? Well, they might be okay, but the issue is going to be one of scale. You might find, for example, in this census data, that one of the dimensions or one of the attributes is much, much larger than another one. So for example, this data set has hours per week, which is obviously going to be somewhere between naught and maybe 60 or 70 hours for someone that's got, you know, a very strong work ethic, and salary, right? Or salary or income or any other measure of, you know, of monetary gain. Now, obviously hours per week is going to be in the tens, and salary could be into the tens of thousands, maybe even the hundreds of thousands. Those scales are not even close to being the same. That means if you're doing clustering or machine learning on this kind of data, you're going to be finding that salary is kind of overbearing everything, right? So it's going to be very easy for your clustering to find differences in salary, and it's harder for it to spot differences in hours because they're so small in comparison, right? So we need to start to bring everything onto the same scale. The more attributes you have, which is another way of saying the more dimensions you have to your data, then the further everything's going to be spread around. If we can scale all of these values to between, sort of, let's say around 0 and 1, then everything gets more tightly sort of controlled in the middle, and so it gets much easier to do clustering or machine learning or any kind of analysis we want. So let's look back at our data and see what we can do to try and scale some of this into the right range. So we're going to look back at the head of our data again. So our numerical values are things like the capital gain, the capital loss, which I guess presumably how much money they've made and lost that year, probably normalized on some scale. And then things like the hours per week that they work. Then their salary, which at this case is greater than or less than 50,000. So let's have a quick look at the kind of range of values we're looking at here so we can see if scaling's even necessary. You know, maybe we got lucky and the person did it before they sent us the data. So we're going to apply a function across all the columns, and we're going to calculate the range of the data. So this is going to be apply on the census data, dimension 2, so that's all the columns, and we're going to use the range function for this. And this is going to tell us, okay, so for example, the age ranges from 17 to 90, the educational level from 1 to 16. It gives you the range for things like nominal values as well, but they don't really make any sense. I mean, working class ranges from question mark to without pay. I mean, that is meaningless. And then, so for example, capital gain ranges from 0 to nearly 100,000, and capital loss from 0 to 4,000. And finally, the hours per week ranges from 1 to 99. So you can see that the capital gain is many orders of magnitude larger in scale than the hours per week. We're going to need to try and scale this data. What we'll begin by doing to make our lives a little bit easier is just focus on the numerical attributes, right? So we don't have to worry about the nominal values, which we've not codified yet. We're going to select all the columns from the data where they are numeric. So that's this line here. Place that down here. So we're going to S-apply, that applies over each of the fields. Is it numeric? And that's going to give us a logical list that says true or false, depending on whether those columns are numeric. What we're doing here is selecting from this list any that are true and then finding their names. So what are the names of the columns that are numeric? So let's have a look at just the range of these attributes to make our life a little bit easier. So I'm going to run this line. And so this is a simplified version of what I was just showing. you can see that capital gain is massive compared to the hours per week, for example. Let's have a look at the standard deviation. Recall that the standard deviation is the average distance from the mean, so it kind of gives us an idea of the spread of some data, right? Is it very tight and everyone earns roughly the same, or is it very spread out and there's huge deviations? And the answer is, there's pretty huge deviations. So the age has a standard deviation of 13, so obviously that means that most people are going to be kind of in the middle, and on average they're going to be 13 years younger or older. But you can see that things like capital gain have over 7,000 standard deviation, which is a huge amount. To give you some idea what we're aiming for, it's very common to standardize this kind of data so that the standard deviation is 1. Right? So 7,000, much too big. Let's plot an example that gives you some idea of what the kind of problem is when we have these massive ranges. So I'm going to plot here a graph of age versus capital gains. Right? We know age goes between about 1 and 100, and capital gain is much, much larger. So if I run this, basically the figure makes no sense at all. Because the capital gain range is from 0 to 100,000, and there's a few people earning right at the top scale, everything is sort of squished down the bottom. We can't see anything that's going on. There's no way of telling whether the capital gain of an individual is related to their age. I mean, it probably is, right? Because of retired people, people who are very young, perhaps earn slightly less. But we can't really see that here because it's just too compressed, right? We need to start trying to bring these things together so that we can perform better analysis. What we're going to do is create a new data frame with just the numerical attributes that we want to focus on just to make our life a little bit easier. And then we're going to write a normalized function to move all our data to between 0 and 1. And we will do this per attribute. So for example, if you've got some data which goes between a minimum and a maximum, and we want to scale this data to between 0 and 1, all we need to do is, first of all, take away the minimum, and that's going to move everything to be from 0 to max minus min. And then we're going to divide by this distance here. So this is max minus min. And if we divide by this, everything is going to go from 0 to 1. So that's exactly what we're doing in this function here. We've got a function x, and it subtracts the minimum of x, and then divides by the difference between the maximum and the minimum. Right, so this is very standard. So we're going to run this. R lets you write functions like this and then use them in applications over data. So we're going to calculate a normalized census data set, which is we're going to apply over dimension 2 this normalized function we just wrote. And then now if we look at the range, we'll see that our range is now between 0 and 1 for all of our data, which is exactly what we want. Normalization is a perfectly good way of handling your data. If everything is between 0 and 1, we have fewer problems with the scale of things being way off. Right? Now, some statistical techniques, like PCA, that we're going to talk about in another video, they require standardized data. That's data that is centered around 0, it has a mean of 0, and a standard deviation of 1. Now, we can standardize data pretty easily in the same way. Actually, we don't need to write our own function for this. The scale function in R performs this for us. So we're going to take the census data or the numerical attributes, and we're going to call the scale function, and that's going to take all of the attributes and center them around their mean. So that means the mean will become close to 0, and it's going to divide them all by the standard deviation, so their standard deviation becomes 1. So if we run that and then we have a look at the mean of this data, so for example here, we calculate the mean, you can see that, I mean, these values are very, very close to 1. That's 10 to the minus 17 or something like that. Very, very small. And if we look at the standard deviation, similarly, they're all going to be 1. Right, so this is now standardized data. This is a very good thing to do if you want to use your data in some kind of machine learning algorithm or for some kind of clustering. Let's imagine now that we want to join some data sets together. Right, so we've standardized data. Everything's between 0 and 1, or it's centered around 0 with a standard deviation of 1. We've codified some attributes. What happens if we get other data from other sources? You can imagine that census data from the US might be a bit useful, but maybe we want census data from Spain or from the UK or from another country. Can we join all these together to get a bigger, more useful data set? Right. Now, the thing to think about when you're doing this is just to make sure that everything makes sense. Right? Are the scales the same? Are they all normalized? Are none of them normalized? Because otherwise what you're going to be doing is you're going to be adding, you know, pay between 0 and 100,000 to somewhere between 0 and 1, nothing makes any sense anymore. You're going to wreck your data. Right? So let's have a look at this on the census data set. We have some Spanish census data in a very similar format to our census data from the United States. Let's have a quick look. So I'm going to read the CSV file for the Spain data. Now let's remind ourselves of the columns that we had in our census data from the United States. These are the numerical columns. So we have age, education number, capital gain, capital loss, this kind of thing. Let's look at the Spanish data set to see if we can just join the two together. So I'm going to run head Spain. That's going to give us the first few rows. And you can see that there's some of the stuff in there is as it was before. So things like what their level of education is, whether they work in the private sector or the public sector. Right, we're going to need to remove these things to create just the numerical attributes. And the other problem is, if you look carefully, you'll see that the capital gain in the Spanish data set is in euros, not in dollars. Right? Now, that's a huge problem. They're not massively different, obviously, they're on the same order of magnitude. But we don't want to be jamming capital gain in euros next to dollars because those two scales are not the same. Right? So what we need to do first is scale this data using some kind of exchange rate. So here what we're going to do is we're going to create a new column in Spain. So given the Spain data frame, we're going to say the Spain capital gain is equal to the euro capital gain times by 1.13, which is the exchange rate we're going to use. Now, it's quite important in this kind of situation not just to look up the exchange rate online. You've got to consider that this might have been collected a while ago. What was the exchange rate when this data was collected, right? These are things you're going to have to think about. So let's run that line, and let's do the same thing for the capital loss. Now, we're going to keep just the numerical attributes of our census data and of the Spanish data. And we're also going to add another column that is what country they come from. Otherwise, we're not going to know. So we're going to use the column bind function to combine the census data's numerical attributes and the native country, which in this case will be the United States. We're going to do the exact same thing for the Spain data, which will be basically exactly the same, except obviously we're also going to have Spain as the native country. And then we're going to use the row bind feature to just join those two tables together. Now that will only work if those two data sets have the exact same attributes. New census not found. What did I do wrong? So I had a typo. So let's join these two together using R bind. There we go. And so our United data set now has the combined observations for the United States and Spain. Now, what you wouldn't want to do is just join them together and just leave it at that, right? You want to perhaps have a little look at some plots to make sure that the distributions of the data you've just joined together make sense. For example, right, the United States data has a nice broad distribution of different ages. We want to make sure that the Spanish data has that same distribution, otherwise you're kind of going to skew your data set. So, for example, let's have a look at roughly whether the levels of capital gain are approximately the same for both the United States and the Spanish data set. So we're going to use ggplot for this. And we're going to plot a bar chart where we've color-coded United States and Spain. And you can see that, broadly speaking, there's a lot in the kind of around zero or less than 50k. And then there's a few a little bit above. Right? So that looks, broadly speaking, the same distribution. I'm fairly happy with that. This is going to be a judgment call when you get your own data. So I'll clear the screen. And then let's have a look at the next plot. So the next plot is going to be capital loss versus the native country. Let's make sure those distributions are the same. So it's plotting that. And broadly speaking, again, yes, the majority are down the bottom. And then there's a few United States ones and a couple of Spanish ones up at the top as well. Again, it's not a disaster. That's probably OK. Finally, let's have a look at ages by native country. So if we plot this, we can see two very, very similar distributions. You can see that it's essentially a bell curve, maybe slightly skewed towards older participants for the United States, and very, very similar for Spain. This is OK. If we hypothesized that capital gain, capital loss, and salary were something to do with your age, then it would make sense to have two data sets that you're joining together have very similar distributions in this regard. So let's look at one more data set from Denmark. Right, so it's the same thing, same format. We're going to read the CSV, and we're going to have a look at just the top few rows to make sure it's in the same format. So that's using the head function. And you can see, actually, we've already removed the nominal and other text attributes from here, and we've just got the numerical ones. And actually, also, capital gain and capital loss are already in dollars in this data set, so we don't have to perform a conversion. So we can use R-bind to put these two things together. And now we just need to check the distributions are the same. So again, we're going to put the age against the native country and see if these two are the same distributions. And actually, you can see this isn't looking too good. The United States and the Spanish data set have very similar distributions. The participants, or the people who have been polled from Denmark, are much, much older on average. Right? This could have an effect on things like capital gain, so I wouldn't necessarily feel comfortable just joining this data set in without you thinking about it a little bit more closely. Right? So whenever you're joining data set like this, taking data from different sources, think carefully to make sure that it's fair and what you're doing is a reasonable concatenation of data sets. And actually, these are the features that power Spotify's recommender system and numerous others. So we've got things like acousticness, how acoustic does it sound from a zero to a one. We've got instrumentalness, I'm not convinced that's a word. Speechiness, to what extent is it speech or not speech? Right. And then things like tempo.